The next session in our agenda today is the first panel discussion on the topic, Role of Early Stage Investors in Shaping Business in India. Please join me in welcoming the moderator of our panel discussion, Subbulal Telidevara, partner at NuVentures and a seasoned investor and veteran of the industry. Subha, we request you to introduce our esteemed panelists for the first panel discussion of today. Over to you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I would like to welcome members of a star-studded panel, Kris Gopalakrishnan. It doesn't need any introduction. He was behind one of the most successful companies we have in India, Infosys. He was the CEO of Infosys, starting team, founder of Infosys. I would also next welcome Dhiraj Rajaram, founder CEO of Musicma. Dhiraj went to school in Chennai, did his engineering, then went to University of Chicago, started Musicma in 2006. It is a large pure play data analytics company. The next in line is Alok Goel. Alok Goel was behind the success of Recharge. Now, after building successful companies, he's now a venture capitalist. He's a partner at SAIF Partners. And then lastly, I have Shekhar. Shekhar is a partner with Axel Partners. And we all know Axel Partners has some excellent pedigree in building category defining companies. So I think without much ado, I would like to start the discussion. But before we actually start the discussion, I would like to ask the audience, if you have any themes, any topics that you would like the panel to cover. So, sure. So, do you have any topics in mind that you think we should cover? I mean, there is a theme that is given here, early stage investing and how the panel sees it. But is there anything specifically that you would like us to touch?
The question is, with millennials increasingly forming a major part of the workforce, right? What has been your experience in difference in managing this new generation versus the older generation? I don't know if you have any experience in your industry around that.
Okay. So let's collect the questions and see what themes come out, and then we can start the discussion. Anyone else? Yeah, let's give them, yeah.
I don't know how long it will take for us to again come back and get rid of you. We are here for an hour. You can ask any question you want. This is open. As an entrepreneur, you can't be sitting back. Come on.
Hi, I'm Karthik. I'm involved with Venk as one of the venture partners in NuVentures. My question is mainly towards the business pivoting of startups. Many of us have seen that. And the I wanted to know like what you guys think from an early investor's point of view. Would at what stage would be the pivoting be right thing for a startup to do? You know, so on and so forth.
Pivoting, yeah.
Let's collect all the thoughts. That's a good one. Good idea.
I think people are warming up now.
I wanted to understand if you were to say one thing. As an entrepreneur, we have a lot of stuff to do every day. One thing we should focus to build a great company. What is that it would be according to four veterans sitting here?
Pivot, focus.
Millennials.
One thing to success. Yeah. I guess the question is around new investors that are coming into the market, whether they're from China and other countries, and how you think about partnering with them, because we're just undergoing a fundraising round and there's a schizophrenia, I feel, in the market in terms of where the valuations are at. So how do you deal with that reality as an entrepreneur as well?
Yeah,
collection of investors?
He's a foreign investor.
Okay.
He also answered the question of values.
Anyone else? There's one there.
This is for Dhiraj and Kris. As founders of companies, when you look to do early stage investing in new companies, like what do you look for, having been founders yourself? Do you think you think differently from investors, or do you think your thinking is very similar?
Okay, maybe.
Any other topic? Srini, anything from your perspective, I'm my favorite company in this.
So, I mean, we were in a unique position where we are sitting in India. Business was US focused, trying to raise fund in India. So, you know, how do we deal with that kind of situation, actually? I mean, thanks to our relationship with Axel, and Axel always backed us. But I think many people would face this similar situation. How do you deal this kind of situation?
Raising money from India.
When your core business focus is not in India.
Yeah.
Yeah, my other question is just about scaling culture. As you're going from 1 to 20 to 100, at what point and how does culture change, your companies change? How do you manage that? Because culture ultimately keeps your companies going, so.
Okay, that's culture.
Scale culture.
Mm. So why don't we start with, I think there is a broad theme of people and teams and millennials versus how do you build the culture? Why don't we start with Kris? I think you know you have scaled on this front significantly, and you're very well known for a strong backbone of culture in your company. So can you give us your thoughts on this aspect of millennials and companies that are now looking for scale, and how do they tackle this?
Yeah. See, every generation thinks that the previous generation don't understand them. Okay, so my parents would try to figure out, you know, what is important to me and my friends, and now I'm trying to figure out what is important to my daughter, and I still have not understood actually how to manage that gap that exists. But when you look at, you know, a basket of things that people look for, and that's what I would always suggest that you use, because you know somebody will be motivated by money, so you'll always find people motivated with money. You'll find people motivated with purpose and goals and aspiration and things like that. You'll find people motivated with working with great teams. You know, they want to work with peers that they respect, and or even brands, individuals that they think are brands. Good work, great work, you know, working with amazing ideas and technologies. What I mean to say is there isn't one thing that will be important. It is actually a portfolio. What you need to do as a founder is to make sure that you know, you have some strengths. You can't, so authenticity is important. So you have some strengths, maybe your idea is unique and brilliant, or you are a great leader and, you know, people recognize as you're a great leader. You have maybe a technology that is, you know, somebody was talking about blockchain, etc. So you need to understand your strengths, and then you know what you want, you know, whom you're going to recruit, what you're looking for. And you need to project the right message to that individual. Ultimately, it's about selling your company to that individual and make it as authentic as possible, because when they join you and they find that what you said is just BS, okay, they're going to be so disappointed that it's actually be destructive for the company. And the larger the team, so what happens is, see, the change that happens is, initially, it's all informal. You can talk to each other, you know, have maybe 3 meetings a day with the team, etc., etc. over time, these things will need to move to processes, will have to be made more programmatic, you know, systematic. You will have to have an HR department, maybe when you cross 1,000 employees, 2,000 employees. So the culture gets built by the leaders of the company and the new people who join. So you need to make sure that you keep talking to the core team that you have. They need to embrace that. They then need to talk to their team. And culture gets built through stories. Culture gets built through, this is how we do things in this company. And then that becomes habit and people know, okay, this is how I should operate. So when I look at Infosys, actually, you know, we the talk, there is no difference between a CEO and an employee. A rule is a rule. Everybody follows the same. So, you know, a great example, when I just took over as CEO, there something happened and I got some shares, Infosys shares, but circumstances were such that I couldn't report it within 48 hours. So it had to be disclosed. I paid a fine. Rule is the same for everybody. Right? So that's how culture gets built. And then that story spreads and culture gets built.
Let's add a word on the culture. If you look at two of the world's greatest companies, Google and Apple, Google is very much of a bottom-driven culture where everyone knows what is going on in the company, what is the strategy. A lot of numbers are quite transparent with everyone out there. Whereas if you look at Apple as a company that is ultra-secretive, engineer would also often also not know what product he is actually working on, what is the end outcome. Imagine you building, writing code or building something where you don't even know what is the real outcome that is going to be. But if you look at the end of the day, both companies work, both companies have created tremendous value, both companies are awesome. Now, is one culture bad or other culture good? I would say cultures are not bad. It is basically what works for you. So as a founder, I would say the foremost thing is to actually figure out what works for you, whether you want Google kind of culture, Apple kind of culture, or something like different kind of culture. But it has to work for you. And when I say it has to work for you, what I essentially mean is that, like Kris was talking about, culture gets built by way of stories. Culture gets converted from these stories into habits. And these habits are actually built by way of your team, senior management team, and everyone in the employee base, seeing how you are making decisions, how you are behaving. So as a founder, when I am taking decisions under pressure circumstances, under difficult circumstances, my team is actually going to see how I took the decisions. And what they see in me is essentially what gets translated as a culture. Culture is not about having fun, having picnic, having dinner, beer, those kind of things. Culture is how we behave. Culture is how we take decisions. And that largely percolates from the founder. And as the company scales up, essentially what you seeded as the early in the early days of the company is essentially what gets translated as a broader culture in the senior management. A founder cannot expect employees or the senior management to be ultra transparent and honest with numbers if he is not being honest with rest of the people. Because if rest of the people are seeing that this is the way decisions are made, they are going to say it's fine, I can also manage numbers in front of the CEO, right? So essentially it is how you behave is what is going to get defined as the culture. And this culture is defined in very, very early formative years of the company. Because if you make wrong decisions at that time, culture is set, you have gotten certain kind of people, you have trained them, it's very, very hard to change it later on. Those are just a couple of cents on the culture.
Can you guys hear me? Yeah. So I think to answer your perspective on millennials, right, I'll just, something has happened at midnight, okay? And the rules of the game that existed in the past are no more true post-midnight. But all our rules have been created with such vehemence that it's hard for us to question them. I just want us to just keep that as a theme as you think about what you're going to do, because you are going to look forward, you know? As Khalil Gibran says, you are the bow you're the arrow that goes front, the bow must bend as a child, you know, when you're thinking about children. So your idea is a child and it's going forward. So my simple perspective that I have learned in the last decade is that we are becoming networks more and more and more, which means that as you think about what is true in the world of a post pre-midnight world versus the post-midnight world, if you were to look at it, pre-midnight worlds were driven by control. Post-midnight worlds are going to be driven through influence. Pre-midnight worlds are driven through hierarchy. Post-midnight worlds are going to be devised by a world called Loraki. You know, pre-midnight world is going to be, you have to manage people. The post-midnight world is you have to let people express themselves. Pre-midnight world, the founder is really important. And because that perspective of centrality, you know, is there. Post-midnight world is that actually founder is important because he originated for sure. But post-midnight, the interactions have become far more important than the entities. Hydrogen and oxygen can create life-giving water or life-taking hydrogen peroxide, depending on how the interactions take place. And culture in networks is nothing but interactions. Now, how you influence it, how you, stories is going to be important for sure. All of these things are going to be important for sure. But I think this world of networks, what we are finding is, especially we are faced by millennials, the millennial issue more than pretty much many other people, because India, the demographic dividend also comes with the problem that our pyramid is becoming flatter, faster and faster and faster. We don't have middle managers. And the rules of the game are changing from pre-midnight to post-midnight really, really fast. So there's a lot of mistakes that we'll have to make. Many of those mistakes are going to seem costly, but they're essential to go through. So my single line in which I would talk about for you is what seems right, so right, that could be wrong post-midnight, you know, in the network world. That's what you should be constantly asking. If it seems very, very right, I would actually get a little scared. What are the things that you do that seem very, very right and make you comfortable? That's the thing that I would question. You know, so
if you actually link this point about, you know, early
seeds of building a culture and
the team, the challenge that I think many of these guys would have is it's a fledgling company. They are into product development. They are worried about whether they need to pivot. And they also have the challenge of building the first team, the initial, the technology head, if you don't have one, or the sales guy for the geography that you want to get into, etc. So at what point, to Richard's question about focus, you know, at what point do you get into broader company building activities like culture, etc.? Because it is, you know, you could be more worried about mundane things like, you know, is my product development going at the right pace? And you have a small team of, many of them have 8 people, right? So when do you and how do you do this transition?
Yeah, so I have a complete different viewpoint on this. So I think I was part of 2 startups myself, I've seen that journey. We made a lot of mistakes during that process. Some were phenomenally successful. I thought all those successes were because of me. Then after becoming a VC, and then now I'm correlating after 15 years. It was nothing to do with me. There's something happening there. And all the mistakes I thought I was making were actually not mistakes. So at least my generalization is that we don't spend enough time in the market. So we start as a founder, like the home lane example, or the parent lane example, right? As a parent, I saw something, I want to do it. And I talk to a set of parents nearby and get started.
So you're in your own bubble.
So what I have seen is every founder starts with an idea and retrospectively, if you're very successful, that bubble is the old country's bubble. You can explain, I had the great insight and all of them. Retrospectively, always works. But forward looking, we don't spend enough time in the market. So for that market, market means what? There are set of agents in that market in terms of customers who are willing to buy. There are set of influencers and a set of behaviors that exist. In that world, you are trying to say as an entrepreneur who have no money, no brand, but massive passion to say, I will penetrate and do something. So that lack of clarity in the market is the biggest source of most of the issues I see in our entrepreneurs, whether it is funded, not funded, seeded, angel, none of it matters, right? So clarity of the market is very, very essential. And that clarity, once you have it, then I work backwards. In that market to be successful, what kind of a team, ignore your company for a second, what kind of a team I need it to be able to satisfy what that market is. If I'm doing this phone-based service as you have for the in a counseling, the type of team you need there is completely different from building a SaaS company that you are building for a global enterprise or a B2C company. So, but we always look internally, oh, what are your team there, how do I make them motivated, what's my culture? You may have a great culture. If that is, doesn't satisfy what the market wants, it doesn't matter. So that first starting with the market, what does the market wants, then I work with a team that is better, superior than the market, then hire the team that satisfies it. I would align my culture, everything working backwards. You look at the best of the companies, like, you know, quoted was Amazon. Take a look at it. With the, such a large money, $1 trillion valuation, frugality is still their number one. And you don't have free soda and free anything in the office. And most of our funded startups in Axel portfolio, before Series A, they have massive, right? This is a $1 trillion company still, because that is the culture code. They thought every extra dollar I'm going to give back to the market.
Doesn't it come down to the founder? The culture is the founder's personality for a long time.
No, my belief is founder has to align to the market. The team has to align to the market. Culture has to align to the market. So yes, but a founder, it depends on the founder, but founder misses the market expectation and not alignment happens, yeah, it doesn't matter.
He won't even be there. So what you see, there's an adverse selection problem. Mm. Only you see aligned things. Right. All the other things, there are 10,000 sperms that would have left, you know, your parent. Mm. Only one of them became you, right? Yeah. So you only see that one person. So this is the aligned thing that you're seeing. And my perspective, what he's seeing is showing is the use case of networks. Yeah. Because the network is the market. Market has all these interactions coming through. And my perspective is you can't, like, there's no start date and date for culture and all. It's like breathing. You breathe out. You breathe in, breathe out. It's like a way of life. You know, it's just that. And you don't, I don't know if I can ever build a culture here. That's like such a big thing to say. I'll build a culture. It's a set of interactions. So many people are going to interact. I mean, I think you can be you, you know. And I think being oneself itself is so hard, right? At all points of time, I have to think about. Abhi ye bolunga to kya sochenge? Ye kya sochenge? Wo kya sochenge? Right? All the time, our authenticity is questioned, and we want to look good. We want to say the right things. We want to say all. And it's like, and all the time feedback of success is on, success or failure or whatever is on us. So we want to, you know, yeah. So this perspective of, like, for me, I'm a big thing to say that, you know, just be, you know, and if you're meant to be, you will be there.
You know, you have a panel of some successful people. So you should ask questions about people who are not so successful. You'll get a different answer. Dheeraj's answer is because he's successful, he doesn't care.
No,
that's what he's saying.
I've seen failure. I've seen real big failure. I'm telling you, I've seen the failure.
No, Dheeraj, you know, I'm telling you.
I don't know if there is no one person, I'm just one person, perspective is that there's no journey which is only successful. There's a lot of...
Yeah, balance, the balance sheet is actually positive.
Yeah.
Right?
I think the balance sheet say, you know, but, you know, see, balance sheet is a point of time. Income statement is every day, and you know, the cash flow is the only thing that is real. The combination of all of these things is what works, And my perspective is that it comes down to how much authenticity can you bring to yourself.
Yeah, authenticity is important. But see, you know, what both of them are saying is start with the market. Mm-hmm. I completely agree. You know, if you don't have a product that the market does not want or the market is willing to buy, then thinking about other things doesn't matter. Right? That's all they're saying.
No, I'm actually saying a little bit different from him. He's saying start with the market and confirm yourself to that. I think that's so artificial. Don't try to do that. You won't be successful. Just be yourself.
Dhiraj, you have to give them points that they can take home, okay? Your philosophy is very, very good.
But I'm saying that
be philosophical after becoming successful.
But I'm saying something else. I'm trying to say that if you start trying to fit, become somebody else for a market, that can, you cannot last for long. So eventually it will come out.
Okay. Yeah, I agree.
I like something too.
Founder market fit. Okay.
Nice word.
Sorry, market founder fit. I prefer market first. So market founder fit. I have seen examples after examples of pitch. Like I met a company, a founder who is working from a security, internet security company. An internet security company, by default, you have to be paranoid, right? You see this, they have come to steal my money. That's the internet security companies. You're paranoid about people, you have dual authentication to enter the company, and no, you don't trust anybody, you have protected things, or how production infrastructure is not accessed by other than one, you're rotating of, you know, crypto, you know, encryption keys, all that. That person says, I want to build a consumer social networking like website. Way orthogonal to what the mindset is. They can act, they can try, but the natural state of that person is not ready for that, and that's what he's trying to say.
And so don't do things that is not in your natural state, because it makes sense from somewhere else. He, as an investor, they have to do all that. Is this fit right? Is this market right? All of that. Because they are looking from outside in. But you are the thing. You are the thing, and you are part of the thing, and you are making it happen.
It's a journey, isn't it? Like you start somewhere. There are the challenges of pivoting the business model, and there is also constant need to seek clarity, to get clarity to yourself.
Absolutely.
And the fit. Absolutely. That you require.
And how much you are changing also
the thing. I think someone asked this question, like when you invest as entrepreneurs versus, you know, venture capital funds investing, do you see things differently when you evaluate a team that comes to you, Kris?
Some things are same probably, because the idea, the team, etc., are probably the same. Where I would personally differ is, I would give them a little bit longer. A fund has a fixed horizon. They have a term. They have to return money. I invest my money, right? So I can take risks which a fund probably cannot take. And I may give a longer rope to a startup. Wrong probably, because you want, you know. See, every startup starts with a hypothesis. And your objective must be to prove that hypothesis or disprove it before you run out of money. Right? If you prove it, you get more money. And so, and if you disprove it, it's better to start with another hypothesis than, you know, go with that hypothesis again and again and try raising money. So when it comes to people like me, I may be a little bit more longer term.
I know I always wonder about one thing. Many times we hear something like, if the rest of the world says your idea sucks, it's not really going to work, that's the idea that you should work on. It's something that people talk about, right? On the other hand, you have this challenge after you have started off, you are hearing from the market signals that you don't think are good. So, and you're probably told by your investors that it is time for you to pivot. So how do you come to terms with these two? And I'm sure that many of the, you know, audience here at some point have grappled with it, or they're probably now grappling with it.
So how do you put these two together?
Yeah. So it's a very, you know, very tough question, because where the founders started, they started with an hypothesis and an intention to see a difference, right?
So either the difference is already happening that they know, but the rest of the world don't know. They have some insight. That's where this, your comment about that everybody says it's a bad idea, but you are starting out that's a good idea, right? So that is the hypothesis, your intent that you believe this is the way world is going to be. And hence, I'm going to build my company around that world. What happens is many times, your thought about the market and the world will not match from a timing perspective. Sometimes companies are way early and you have to wait. It will happen one day, but you may run out of patience, you may run out of money, and that time you have to choose, let me low burn, wait until the market develops, and then I will take the wave. Or you have some insight that I can change the market in my favor. Both are options available. But the challenge I see is always is the capital, the money required to keep you and waiting for that is always the most precious thing. When things align, when a wind is in your favor, when suddenly starts happening, you will get the benefit. Like, you know, in our own India, there are examples, right? For Flipkart, we told them very early on that based on our other experience with BookMyShow and other companies, that mobile is happening in India. They rejected until they went the other extreme. I will do only mobile. They shut down the desktop, yeah. Right? So they went other, but it took at least a 2 years delay. They had the capital, so they could do multiple mistakes, but still they could survive, right? So question of, do you have an insight that is developing that you believe one day the world is going to be like this way and everybody is going to behave this way, but I don't have time or patience, pivot it. If you believe I have the ability to capture that market and I am the best team in the world, I will continue on.
Actually, the correlation that you were talking... Actually, the correlation that you were talking about, I actually disagree with that. Mm-hmm. It is not that if everyone is saying this idea sucks, it is probably the best idea to work on. It is more of... There is a reason why investing and entrepreneurship both are extremely lonely journeys. Because if it was so obvious, then everyone would have invested in that idea and everyone else would have done that idea. There is a reason why this kind of an attractive opportunity remains, which is hidden, which might be really, really large opportunity because people don't know and the market is not developed about this particular idea. And this founder, as Shekhar was talking about, has got a unique insight on why that market still exists out there and why I am the best guy who can actually solve that problem. And sometimes founders have that kind of overconfidence, which is fine, which is good enough to get them into this kind of a entrepreneurship journey, but then they have to really figure out their right to win in that particular market. So it's more like great ideas are generally discarded. For example, when we invested in ShareChat about 3 years back, that time there was no vernacular, there was no content, there was no geo, there was no video wave in India, there was no Tutiao of China, that was being talked about in India at that point of time. They were solving a very, very unique pain point of the consumers, and they had done enough experiments to know that they are the only ones who had that kind of an insight. And then they kept building on it, and now, like Dheeraj talks about, they are monopolistic because they had that insight and they could establish their network because other people are not competing with them. But today the content space is like super hot and everyone is trying to work on that space, and that is where it becomes even harder to build new businesses. So yes, ShareChat was like a super stupid idea, but it doesn't mean that every stupid idea is worth actually trying at this point of time.
One perspective about founders being investors. This is very subjective. I have decided that I should not be an investor. I just feel that I think the ecosystem, the way it works is there are people who are going to maximize others, by investing into them or investing into their idea. If you look at an investor and an employee, both of them, to some extent, have similarities in the fact that the employee is saying, I'll give you my services, you founder, make it better. Okay? The investor is saying, I'll give you my money, make it better. employee is saying, I'll give you my services, make it better. And the founder is saying, I'll take all of these things and I'll orchestrate something around that and make it something valuable, right? So this is a very simple perspective with which I have understood based on all the mistakes I have made. So I feel that if your natural design of your internal DNA is in that 0-to-1 perspective, which is like, I'll make things, I'll take these resources from other in my ecosystem and make something out of it, then what happens is, if you try to become that other DNA, which is that I will become an investor suddenly, many times I have found myself trying to think that, what would I do if I were them? And sometimes it's the worst possible thing to do, because it's them who are going to build the company. So I do think that, though it's not like a complete, it's like male, female, nobody is a complete male and complete female. There is a little bit of male, female in everybody. Otherwise, you won't have hair removal creams. So the perspective I would say is that, but if you are on that extreme, like male, female, here, this intrinsic versus extrinsic on the resource, this thing, I think you should know exactly, maybe you are not, so there is like complete super founding by people. Those guys are going to be very bad employees. They are going to become very bad investors also. And on the other hand, if you are in between, then you can actually go both ways. So you have to ask yourself, who's the best? I think the best set of investors, I would say, are people like Kris and Shekhar are people who have, I think, somehow toggled between the two. So it's important that you can do that. I could be wrong, but
yeah. So, I agree with Dhiraj, and I will tell you, when you are the CEO, etc., you have to give 150% or 200% to your company. At that point, I wouldn't suggest, if I were an investor, to become an investor. Okay, because you don't have time. When I stepped down from Infosys, 2014 October is when I started investing. Till that time, no investment, no other boards, only Infosys. My life was Infosys.
I think we are running out of time, but just I would like to ask one question. Probably this was not raised, but I'm sure it is in the mind of all these guys. If many of them are trying to raise Series A or Series B type of funding, how much time would they need to keep in mind? How much time would it take, assuming that they have got few things in place? In current market situation, to raise $1 million to $3 million kind of money.
So there is no exact formula for how and when. What I have seen is people somehow think that funds, Axel does this way, SAIF this way, and so on, or new ventures. Mm-hmm. It's actually about what Shekhar thinks, yeah, and what Alok thinks. So it's a individual inside a fund.
Right? This was SAIF bet.
Yeah. So there is a themes. Overall themes in each funds would have, and which themes matter to them, and so on. Like, for example, we want to be having some technology edge as one of the theme for us. We don't do too orthogonal to that. If you have to do, then somebody has to explain extraordinarily why we are doing it. So that's the part. And each member also has their own viewpoint. And those viewpoints, you can't question me saying why you think that way. That's who I am, and that's what Axel believes, why they have hired me, and I'm part of that. And my viewpoints are also, I say, maybe wrong, maybe right, and only time I know is 10 years from now. Right? So does you. You also will know 10 years from now whether you are right or wrong. And by that time, we can argue and say, I was right, you are right, but it doesn't matter. Time has gone. Right? So the challenge is, this matchmaking is, who believes in your world of the future? Because you're not in the past, not in the present. It's about the future. Your world of the future being extraordinarily big. In that big future, you take a dominant monopolistic position to build a sizable company that aligns with the investor's theme, saying that, wow, that looks interesting. And hence,
that may be a time. So that is for me, usually at Series A, you're asking for a decent amount of money, which means that there has to be some proof in the pudding in terms of what traction have you seen in that world and how are you going in that direction and whether the direction you can lead to something extraordinary big. That is what I would say.
Raising money or not, they need to do a lot of homework to see that fit, to understand.
Exactly. No, it is like sales. No, pitching to a fund and getting money is like sales 101. You know, is there a need in the fund? Is that person believes, if I've already done lots of investments in that category and I'm already burnt, like, you know, very hard to convince me saying that take money some more. There are examples after examples where people take early bets. Just like you, we have taken early bets in categories. Nothing has worked. Say we have done 5 investments in a category. Nothing has worked. 6th extraordinary company comes. I will be a little bit more worried because I also have a say among my colleagues, right? I have to see them daily. And the one person is saying that I just sold the company for 16 billion. And I'm saying, you know, yeah, I'm thinking about this company, right? Everybody has this pressure point. So we as a company, we as a team, we have to make decisions and day in, day out, which idea we are going to pack. And the good news is it takes 10 years for anybody to know what is right, what is wrong. But in that journey, it has to make sense. So, you know, for me, in the case of Girish, as an example, nobody would touch him because he doesn't have a IIM Bangalore or IIM. Nobody has got IIT background. And, you know, he's come from a company which has not raised money at all, like Zoho. And he was sitting there. And when I met with him, it's about this insights. He was very crystal clear how the world is going to be in the future. And his viewpoint of what I'm going to build and why I'm going to be successful, that clarity of thought was extraordinary. And you couldn't argue against that future or against the thought he was explaining. Then I said, it's a great investment to make. And once you have that, the rest will fall in place. But most of the time, as I said, you know, the clarity came from where? For him, clarity came from Zoho. He has been there. He is watching Zendesk for 2 years. He's saying, Shekhar, hundreds of feedback. People are putting only effort on sales. They have reduced the product team to a tiny. They are not even responding to the customer's feedback of what the feature set is. I've already done 3 of us already built this product, less than 6 people. I've already got the product better than them. It's a matter of time how I can going to get there. So that, you know, vision of his thought, he still holds. The first product he started with, same code base, same product, same feature, is getting in a high double digit million revenues already in the company. Single thought, 2007 to until now. Same thing holds. Only more people, more sales team, more engineering, more things, but the thought hasn't changed.
So Venk, let me give you a different perspective. It's a crowded space. Everybody now talks about startup. Right, and all of them will get pitched a lot. So you start with actually, you know, send me a presentation, and you do flip through who are the founders, right? So, you know, the problem for somebody like Girish is, okay, he has a background because he has been with Zoho, and it happened that, you know, it struck him. But unfortunately, most people will get filtered out at that point. It's unfortunate. Because you don't even get to meet the person. So then what you have to do is you have to figure out how can I not send a presentation but try and meet. It's only by networking. It's only by somebody introducing you to somebody else so that that person is obliged to meet you. Because if you don't even meet, you don't get an opportunity to pitch. So this is a challenge.
So I have a suggestion for this. This question gets asked to me quite a lot.
So what I tell the founders who don't have, there are two things, what I call as credibility and capability, right? The credibility comes from what school you're gone, where you are. You are pitching from Bangalore versus non-Bangalore, right? Then capability. The credibility part, if you don't have all these degrees, very hard to manufacture. So what I wrote a blog on that saying that you can manufacture credibility by getting to pitch to somebody who is credible to me, like you. If you send a pitch to me, Shekhar, this is an extraordinary team, I don't care where they are from, right? So the question is, you have to find somebody who is credible to the firm. Because I get 2,000 plus pitches per year. We don't have time. As we said, our most valuable thing is time. With 10 plus boards, lots of issues with each of the company, their own fundraise, how much time I allocate to finding a company. So that comes down to building the credibility. The second is the capability. The capability part, many times you can do it, is don't give a damn about any of these things. You proof in the pudding. You show a success. Everything is digital. You demonstrate success, you demonstrate performance, guess what? Me, Alok, everybody will be at your doorstep. It doesn't matter which university you've gone.
I think we have run out of time. Thank you very much. Anyone has any few words to say?
Please. No, all the best to all the people here. And, big successes in the future. It can be done. It can be done.
Thank you, Kris, for taking your time off and being here with us today. Thank you, Dhiraj. Thank you, Alok. Thank you, Shekhar, for being here with us today and sharing your wonderful stories and insights.